I have the opportunity to give the next talk on hereditary colorectal cancer, how not to miss it in your patients. It's not a management talk. Specifically, it was about clues as to how to make the diagnosis, but I think we'll have plenty of time to talk about some of the management questions that are coming across. Okay, so 10% of colorectal cancer cases in the United States are related to a hereditary colorectal cancer syndrome. And I thought I'd just show a basic diagram of the two buckets that I think about, or probably Heather thinks about, when we see patients in clinic. And so really they're polyposis cases and non-polyposis cases, but there are some Lynch patients that do have numerous polyps. And when it comes to the adenomatous polyposis syndromes, I characterize them as those that are adenomatous versus those that are hamartomatous. And within the adenomatous bucket are really FAP, familial adenomatous polyposis, and MAP, MYH-associated polyposis. The hamartomatous syndromes are very uncommon, but those would include Peutz-Jeghers, juvenile polyposis syndrome, P10 hamartoma tumor syndrome, as well as hereditary mixed polyposis syndrome. And then when it comes to non-polyposis, HMPCC is the umbrella term for the diseases that we think about, like Lynch syndrome, familial colorectal cancer type X, and Lynch-like syndrome. The hereditary colorectal cancer syndromes can be identified in part by pathology. So I just put this slide up here to tell you about these different hereditary colon cancer syndromes. They are all autosomal dominant in their inheritance pattern, except for the new kid on the block, MYH-associated polyposis, which is a recessive trait. And you can see that in Lynch syndrome, FAP, and MAP, the precursor lesion is the adenoma. In PJS, JPS, P10 hamartoma tumor syndrome, also known as Cowden syndrome, is one of the variants, as well as the mixed hyperplastic polyposis syndrome. Those are all really hamartomatous polyps. And there is commercial germline testing available for those syndromes. But the objectives over the next 15 minutes or so will really be to identify the key features of the most common hereditary colon cancer syndromes that you will see, including Lynch syndrome, FAP, and MAP, and to be able to implement tools in your practice in order to make the risk assessment, including the family and personal history, as well as molecular genetics. So the red flags for hereditary colon cancer syndromes are really an early age of onset, less than the age of 50, and that could be of either benign or malignant lesions, and in particular the hereditary colon cancer syndromes, it would be colorectal cancer or polyps. Individuals that have synchronous or metachronous tumors, so numerous cumulative lifetime polyps, unusual polyp pathology, and don't forget about extracolonic findings, which are either benign or malignant in nature, and the family history of the disease. So you need to inquire with the relatives. So really recognizing the phenotype, I think, is what you've heard multiple times throughout the last three speakers. You have to take a family history, and the recommendations would be the data needs to be gathered from three generations. Determine the age and cause of death in relatives, because if you have a patient in the office whose parents died in their 40s, you may not have an informative family history, and if they said, no, I don't have colon cancer, you didn't think to ask, did anyone live long enough to actually get the disorder? You also need to document the age of both the benign and malignant tumors, and if the family history smells fishy to you, certainly send that person for a genetics assessment for further investigation of the family tree. Lynch syndrome is the first syndrome we'll talk about. It causes up to 5% of all colorectal cancers. It's defined as an individual with a germline mutation in one of the mismatch repair genes, the two most common mismatch repair gene mutations you will find in your patients, include MLH1 and MSH2. MSH6 makes up about 10% of individuals, and then PMS2 accounts for about 6% of mutations we find in the Lynch syndrome patients. Just a little bit of genetics and molecular biology here. The cancer in Lynch syndrome actually develops from a defect in the DNA mismatch repair genes. And your genome contains many nucleotide sequences that are conserved in all individuals. And there's repeated segments of mono or dinucleotide repeats. Those are the microsatellites. You have the four mismatch repair genes that I mentioned, MLH1, MSH2, MSH6, and PMS2, that produce proteins which are enzymatic complexes that actually identify mismatched nucleotides and repair them. And when you have defective mismatch repair, it can result in a finding in your tumor of microsatellite instability. And this is a typical electropherogram that a pathologist would see in their office if they're doing microsatellite instability on your patient's tumors in the pathology lab. And what you can see is that there's a certain pattern that characterizes normal tissue. And when you have a tumor that's developed through microsatellite instability, you will have an abnormality in these nucleotide peaks. And that comparison between normal and tumor is microsatellite instability. There are approved panels that are used. There's oftentimes pathology departments have their own panel. But suffice it to say, microsatellite instability is characterized when you have two or more of the five nucleotide sequences that are abnormal, or if you're using larger panel sequences, if you have greater than 30% of nucleotide targets that are abnormal. Tumor immunohistochemistry, Heather also referred to, and that is another way that you can identify mismatch repair deficiency. This is an example of MLH1 where you can see the brown staining in the nuclei within the tubulovillous adenoma, and you can actually see brown staining in the tumor. And when you look in this individual whose tumor lacked expression of MSH2, both in the adenoma as well as the tumor, and so this individual actually had abnormal expression of the mismatch repair protein MSH2. And this can be done in formalin-fixed tissue. So if you have a patient in the office that is unaffected with cancer but had a relative with cancer, potentially the genetic counselors can get that tissue and archived specimens can be stained. So the clues to hereditary colorectal cancer include HNPCC. Heather already mentioned the pedigree. It's a 3-2-1 rule. Three relatives with colorectal cancer, two successive generations. One individual with cancer is a first degree to the other two. An individual is diagnosed less than the age of 50, and you exclude FAP. But as Heather had mentioned, about 50% of these individuals don't have a mutation, and the accuracy isn't as good as families are getting smaller and we're being more effective in preventing cancer from developing in our patients. The importance of identifying mismatch repair deficiency in tumors of patients that have the Amsterdam Criteria 1 is that there was this large study that looked at this pedigree and said, everyone's family tree looks alike. Let's look at what happens in terms of cancer risk if you break the patients that meet Amsterdam Criteria 1 into those that have evidence of mismatch repair deficiency and those that don't. You can see that colorectal cancer is much higher in the pedigrees that have evidence of mismatch repair deficiency. They also have a substantially increased risk of extracolonic cancers above the SEER database. And in addition, when you look at the pedigree, that the family tree looks just like this one, but they don't have evidence of mismatch repair, they're at an increased risk of colon cancer compared to the SEER database, but not as high as those that actually have microsatellite instability and no extracolonic cancer risk that you need to worry about screening. But we know that the criteria, the Amsterdam Criteria 1, are very restrictive. It only includes the colon cancer and Lynch syndrome. The syndrome that has a germline mutation in one of the mismatch repair genes is associated with those extracolonic cancers that we just demonstrated in the last slide. So the Amsterdam Criteria 2 have been developed, which incorporate the other extracolonic cancers. And for you sitting in the audience, you need to think about these as the first cancer that may develop in these individuals. Particularly, endometrial cancer is one of the hallmark cancers in Lynch syndrome. It occurs in about 60% of the women with the syndrome, so that may be the presenting cancer. Certainly, if you have unusual skin tumors, sebaceous adenocarcinomas, sebaceous adenomas, keratoacanthomas, there's a variety of unusual skin findings that can be the tip-off, but you can see that there's a potpourri of other tumors that can develop, including brain, hepatobiliary, gastric, and small bowel. The colorectal cancer and Lynch syndrome, this is the other tip. Certainly, the risk over time varies by genotype, but the median age of onset is less than 50. These are proximal tumors, and the pathologist can give you the tip-off. They're mucinous, poor differentiation, tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, and a Crohn's-like reaction. And metachronous colorectal cancer occurs in many of these individuals over time. And this is just a report from a study that looked at individuals that had a Lynch syndrome colorectal cancer. They underwent either an extended hemicolectomy with an iliorectal anastomosis or an iliosigmoid anastomosis versus those that didn't know they had Lynch and underwent a segmental colectomy. And in 11 years of follow-up, no one that had the extended colectomy developed cancer, whereas you can see that 25% of individuals by about 15 years that had the segmental colectomy actually had a metachronous cancer. So that's the importance of identifying these individuals before you send them to surgery for management of their cancer. So what about universal testing for Lynch syndrome? And I just want to mention that the multi-society task force guidelines were just published in August in GIE, the Red Journal, as well as Gastroenterology, and it talks to this point. In addition, the CDC has gotten a work group together to evaluate how we're using genetics and genomics in our practice, and it is the recommendation by both of these bodies that universal testing be considered, and what that is testing all colorectal cancers for evidence of Lynch syndrome. So I work at the Cleveland Clinic, and this is just an example of what we do. When a patient is diagnosed with cancer, the operative specimen is sent down for MSI. That's our first step. And if abnormal, the patient goes on to immunohistochemistry. If immunohistochemistry is abnormal, the patient actually meets with a genetic counselor for a session to discuss the results, and then, if appropriate, genetic testing. Universal tumor testing for Lynch syndrome, I think, is important, and Heather actually did this important article that was published and drives home the point. So they took 1,000 population-based colon cancer samples. 21 individuals actually had a Lynch syndrome-related tumor, evidence of microsatellite instability or mismatch repair. And those patients were found to have germline mutations in one of the mismatch repair genes. Importantly, the phenotype or family tree, 43% of the individuals were diagnosed over the age of 50, and 22% did not meet the Amsterdam 2 or the revised Bethesda criteria. So although family history is quite important, really we need to go beyond that and start looking at the genetics of the tumor to help us decide if the patient has Lynch syndrome. And the other important point to drive home is there are individuals in those 21 patients' families that didn't know they had Lynch syndrome, and they underwent genetic testing, and 52 additional relatives and families were diagnosed with Lynch syndrome. So Heather actually reviewed some of the simple tools that you can put into your practice as how you can evaluate patients for Lynch syndrome. She reviewed the different prediction models, and I just want to show that this is an example of the PREM 126 model that really is quite simple, and it's online with a sensitivity of 90%. The specificity is not quite high, but you can see that these models have been validated and actually are quite useful. Individuals that have a greater than 5% chance of having a germline mutation should undergo a risk assessment and germline testing. This is the other tool that Heather talked about, the risk assessment tool, another three-question tool that is really practical in your endoscopy suite, and quite simply, early age of onset of colorectal cancer or the extracolonic cancers. And so that's family history, the personal history of the cancer or numerous polyps, and then do you have multiple relatives, either first or second degree, that have had colorectal cancer? So quite simply, something that you could put in your endoscopy suite and have a nurse or intake person assess. And of course, if individuals say yes to all of these questions, 95% of Lynch syndrome patients are identified. But what about us and tumor testing? So it's important to diagnose Lynch syndrome patients preoperatively. You can do it by endoscopic biopsy, and I would say, when do we do that? Certainly, if you're doing universal testing, you'd want to do that on the tumors in your patients in the endoscopy suite. The other people to consider it on would be adenomas that are proximal, large, in a young person under the age of 40, and a patient with an adenoma and a suspicious family history for HMPCC or Lynch syndrome. And actually, this work is from the Boston group that compared MSI versus IHC for detection of Lynch syndrome within these polyps, and you can see the accuracy varies on size. So for small lesions, there's only about a 1 in 3 hit rate that on our endoscopic biopsy, we will identify a Lynch syndrome carrier by either MSI or IHC. When the polyps get to be larger, in fact, IHC becomes slightly more accurate. And when lesions are large, a centimeter or greater in size, the accuracy of MSI and IHC is similar. So a small study, but provocative results that if it's an individual that has Lynch syndrome, you can identify by endoscopic biopsy. So that's Lynch syndrome. And let's switch gears to talk about the clues to picking up the adenomatous polyposis syndromes, which include FAP and MAP. And FAP is due to an APC mutation. It's autosomal dominant, and it is not uncommon. 1 in 10,000 individuals in the population have it. There's nearly 100% risk of colorectal cancer at the mean age of 40 if colectomy is not done, but this is variable based on the location of the gene mutation. MAP is the only recessive hereditary colon cancer syndrome. It's due to biallelic MYH mutations and is occurs in a population frequency carrier state of about 2 to 3%. There's about a 60% risk of colorectal cancer, and the mean age is about a decade later than individuals with FAP. And I like this little cartoon. It's from Brandy Leach, one of my genetic counselors. And when you're thinking about cumulative lifetime adenoma burden, this kind of tips you off as to what to think about. So if someone has oligopolyposis, certainly you need to think about FAP due to an APC mutation, but by far and away, the majority of individuals with MAP will have an attenuated phenotype. When you get to 100 to 1,000 adenomas or more, it's much less likely to be related to MAP and much more commonly related to an APC mutation. What are the extra-intestinal features of polyposis that might be the presenting feature for your patient that has only a couple of polyps? Desmoid tumors are these fibrous tumors that can grow within the abdomen of individuals with FAP, and they occur in about 15% of individuals. Thyroid carcinoma can occur up to 15%. Oftentimes, on imaging, these individuals will have adrenal adenomas, but the Gardner's variant of FAP is something where we used to screen individuals for some of the manifestations when we didn't have genetic testing. So congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigmented epithelium, it's these freckles that are oftentimes bilateral and multifocal, and that can be seen in up to 80% of individuals in Gardner syndrome. Supernumerary teeth, those are teeth that never erupted or extra teeth. Osteomas in the mandible, the maxilla, or on the skull can be seen quite commonly. And some of the soft tissue tumors, lipomas, fibromas, sebaceous cysts. And I oftentimes put my hand on the head of my patient when I'm doing endoscopy, when I'm sedating them, and quite commonly I will feel lesions on patients' heads that probably no one else had recognized as on them. So this is one of my patients that has sebaceous cysts and numerous osteomas on his head. Hepatoblastoma is another extraintestinal manifestation of FAP. I've been doing FAP for about 20 years and have not seen it in my practice, but it is one of the childhood tumors that you need to consider. Thyroid cancer and polyposis, as I said, about 3% risk in a prospective study that we did, 17% prevalence in MAP patients. These are usually papillary cancers. They can be the mean or the primary finding in FAP, young age of onset. They're small in size, and importantly in our study, none of the patients that had thyroid cancer was detectable by physical examination, so I'd recommend ultrasound, and that's one of the recommendations by the NCCN. The gastric features of polyposis, fundic gland polyposis is universal in these individuals. The mean number of polyps is about 30. The histology, don't be surprised if there is evidence of low-grade dysplasia. It's not the same as adenomatous low-grade dysplasia. It's foveolar in nearly 50% of individuals. And when we found high-grade dysplasia in our patients' polyps with the adenomatous polyposis syndromes, universally they were in polyps that were a centimeter or greater in size. So I'd encourage you, you can sample the small ones, but snare eradicate large lesions. Gastric adenomas are rare. They're usually in the antrum and occur about 10% of the time. They should be completely resected. The duodenum is where the money is for the gastroenterologist really sitting in the office that's managing their patients after their colectomy. Duodenal adenomas are near universal. You can see where they occur, oftentimes periampullary. If you have a patient with numerous colon polyps and you're thinking, could this be a genetic syndrome, don't forget to do the EGD and biopsy the papilla. We did a study that looked at the frequency of adenomatous changes in the papilla based on the morphologic appearance. 50% of the time, if you biopsy a normal appearing papilla in the adenomatous polyposis syndromes, you will get adenoma. Nearly 90% of the time if it looks funny to your eye. Periampullary and duodenal cancer is a big problem for patients with FAP, and the range is from 2 to 36%. It's really based on the stage of duodenal polyposis, and you need to manage these patients EGD surveillance on their stage of duodenal polyposis. So please keep the stage of duodenal polyposis in mind and its points assigned to the number, size, histology, and degree of dysplasia. And the number of points directly correlates with their ensuing cancer risk and also is important for the frequency in which you do EGD surveillance. So the hereditary colorectal cancer syndromes are very important. They're not so uncommon. You will see them in your practice. Take a family history as the first step. Suggest universal testing for Lynch syndrome with your pathologist and consider colonic and extracolonic manifestations of the diseases as a tip-off to the diagnosis and what you're dealing with. Thanks for your attention, and now I have the opportunity to thank you.